tonight we're going to do volume 3 of the Nook Chat, and it's going to be on the early schools of the Everson area. And my wife, Inez, is here because she was a student in a school that was built in 1906 as a one-room school. It was a two-room school when she went there, but she went through all 8 grades in this little school called Glen Echo. It still exists as a building. So, and our star for next month is here, Don Rackendiver. See, that next month you'll get to hear all about what he knows about Erdy Everson, and he's been here as long as anybody knows anything. And he's a good storyteller, too. So, well, the schools in this area started when the women arrived, because the first people here were all bachelors. And there were no kids, and most of them had all the schooling they ever wanted to have, and so therefore they didn't need schools. But about 1876 or so, Moultrie built a store over at the crossing, which is just west of Everson, and shortly thereafter the women started to arrive. And long there were a couple of families that came with children already produced. And but they were very few, and there was no schools, and so the first school in the area was built at the crossing. And in 1884, which is the first year that there was a census, Nellie Coop, does Coop sound familiar? You've heard of Coopville? Well, Nellie Coop grew up in Coopville. Her dad settled the area of Whidbey Island, and she was the second woman north of Whatcom, second white woman north of Whatcom, and neither Phoebe Judson nor her had any babies yet, so there was no need for schools out here yet. But the crossing, then in 1884, when she went around looking at all the schools, because she was the school the county superintendent of schools at that time, and so she started to count all the schools. Well, at that time, the school at the crossing was the largest school in Whatcom County. It had 113 students in 1884. So you see, a few families had arrived between the 76 when nobody was here and 84 when she was counting. The biggest school in Bellingham had 30. Linden had 30. So you see, 113 was a fairly large school. And the building was built at the crossing, near the store, but the river got to it. The river started to undermine it, so they moved it up to the corner of the trap line and the Stickney Island Road. And they also changed the name shortly after that. I know by 1890, it was known as the Everson School. So when you hear of the Everson School, think crossing school, moved. And then later on in 1914 they built the Everson School, and whenever they built the Everson School, the crossing school was moved over behind the depot and became a grain storage area, and the people can remember it there. And that was one of the early schools. By 84-85 they started to have more children. There were, as you say, there was the largest school in the county. Most of those children either boarded somewhere close by or had a long horseback ride, because they lived miles away from the school. The school wasn't 180 days like it is now. It was whenever everybody could get together and they had school. Then this little school started to develop, and in 1890, by that time, Nooksack was a school. Nooksack, I believe, first had held classes in 85 or 86, and that was in a log house adjacent to the teacher's house. They let them use the old house, the original house, and they built a two-story addition on, and they lived in the two-story addition, so the one-story old log cabin was available for students, and 8 of those students were the teacher's own children. So it was sort of like a homeschool situation. And my grandfather graduated from there in 1892. Of course, in those days, schools only went to the 8th grade. That was as far as you could go. So that, and then by 19, Everson was developed, and Timon was at school by 1890. You know where Timon is? There were five families in Timon that had children, and the Raybergers had the most. They had eight, and there were only five families in that little school, and that school only lasted about 20 years, and then they went to other schools, primarily Everson. And then Glen Echo, the people up around the Glen Echo area where Inez went to school, started to feel the need for school, and they formed in 1905 with 51 students, but they didn't have any schoolhouse. So we don't know for sure where they met. Even by 1906, they didn't have a schoolhouse yet, but in 1906 they did complete the first unit. And Inez's mother was in the eighth grade when they built that school in 1906, and it was a one-room school at that time. And then in 1912, there were enough students to build double the school, so it became a two-room school. So Inez remembers it as a school with the little room and the big room. And who do you think was in the little room? What people would be in the little room?
The boys.
No, boys.
The younger grades.
The big kids.
No, I think
younger grades?
Grades one to four were in the little room. Grades five through eight were in the big room. And the little room had, the teacher was called the teacher. In the big room, he was called the principal. So, and he got $5 a month more. He got $55 a month, and the teacher only got $50 a month. So, but he was responsible for the entire school system, and he normally is the one that filled out the census records. Whatcom County is very fortunate. It is the one of four counties in this state that has the original census records still available. When the county superintendent's office closed in 32 or 33, the superintendents walked out of their office and left all the records there. The county, in their wonderful need for space, decided that these records were not important anymore, so they were supposed to be sent to Olympia for storage. But only four of the counties succeeded in sending their records to Olympia. That's why I know who went to school, when they went to school, how, what their attendance records was, and all of that sort of thing in all of the little schools of Whatcom County. And you can find out when everybody went. So I know that what Inez tells me about her attendance records is accurate, because I have a documented piece of paper that said when she went to school and all that. Now, Inez has a vivid memory of her years in Glen Echo, and I would like for her to kind of tell what it was like to be a student in a school that had no running water and no inside plumbing.
We had a pump.
So, here is Inez Asklin at the time.
But
I'll hold it.
They had a pump out in front, and if boys said naughty words, the teacher and whoever wanted to watch it could go out to the pump. They had a bar soap. They put soap on his mouth. Oh, we felt sorry for him. But and then we had another boy. They called him Leroy Morningstar, Grandpa's boy. And his folks were gone, but he lived with Grandpa. And he was so attentive to Grandpa and vice versa. But I like Leroy. And, but the schools. The little room had 1 to 4, and then it was 5 to 8. And I had two sisters. Evelyn was 5 years older than I was, and Orme was 5 years younger. But three of us went to the Glen Echo School. And or they didn't have a hot lunch. We had to bring our lunch from home. But one day, my mother was into flowers and planting, and so she had brought a bought a bag. They called it tobacco dust. And you could put that on your plants and the bugs would get to them. And it was in a paper sack. And I took a paper sack to school with my lunch in it. Quite a few of us did. And somebody went out in the cloakroom and said, somebody's been smoking out in the lunch, out in the hallway there. Okay, who's been smoking? Well, they said there's a bag that smells like they've been smoking. And they brought this bag out. They said, it does smell like tobacco. And they said, whose lunch is it? It was Inez's. But I said, you know, my mom, I picked up the wrong. Instead of my lunch, I picked up the tobacco dust. And so then they put that way back in somewhere. I don't know where they put it. But what else? The teachers we had were great. We had one teacher and the other was the upper grade. And we had this big, is this big stove still out there?
No, they're gone.
And our janitor, his name was Johnny, and he kind of lost his mind. So they had to get a new janitor, but he kept that schoolhouse warm. I remember that. Mm-hmm. Poor Johnny, he lived with his mother.
She had a little traumatic there because one day the people from Cedar Woolley came to school and took Johnny away, and he never came back.
Yes.
So the things were not done very easily in those days. One of the things I've always thought was interesting, the boys, when they would go out for lunch, would take off their shoes. And when they went back into class, they put their shoes back on, but first they washed their feet at the pump. And the pump had slats, so the water from their feet went right back into the well that you pumped out for your next your drink. The Clean Water Act wasn't in vogue at that time.
It didn't look like feet had been in.
No, it didn't. So, but Inez, sometimes she took a dare, and she took a dare once somebody suggested she wouldn't jump off the woodshed roof.
Well, guess who did? And the kids were all gathered around there. And I jumped off the roof. Well, that knocked me out. I was out. But they got me revived. But I thought I'd never do that again. But they told me to.
I don't know whether you remember Rod Perry, the weatherman up there in Clearbrook.
Bill.
But his dad was named Bill. And Bill's first job out of college, I don't think he'd even gone to college yet, but anyhow, maybe one or two years. His first job was at Glen Echo as the principal. Well, the principal would play with the kids at lunchtime. And Inez was one who just loved to have the principal catch her as they were playing tag.
And he would pick us up. He would pick us up and twirl us around. So we wanted Bill to catch us. But he was a great teacher too. Bill Perry. When did we last see Bill?
Oh, years ago.
But he was good looking. Still good looking.
So sometimes the students did more than other things. The other thing is, you need to remember that there weren't any hotels around, so that the teachers stayed with in the families' homes, and Inez's home was one that housed many of the teachers that came to the school. She had other relatives. Her family, her dad's family of five siblings, and her mother's family of five siblings, all their children went to Glen Echo. So it was really like a family reunion there. And if you read the Glen Echo book, which she and I wrote, you'll find out an awful lot about her family from that book, because they did a lot of things together. The school was eventually closed in 42 when it consolidated. But one of the things, I'm not sure whether the Glen Echo School Board followed this, but the rule was, if you didn't pass the eighth grade test, you didn't go on to high school. You needed to pass the eighth grade test. Well, in some of the school districts, and I'm not sure about Glen Echo, I don't remember this for sure. If the principals, eighth graders, did not pass the eighth grade test, he was fired. So Inez was one who passed. Do you want to tell them about how that testing went?
The what?
The testing, the eighth grade test score. Eighth grade test.
Well, that's okay.
They gave the test in the, both the seventh and eighth grade. They gave sections of it in the seventh and eighth grades. So if you passed it when you were in the seventh grade, you didn't have to take it in the eighth grade.
But we had to go to Everson
to take the test.
School to take our test at the Everson School.
So, yeah, and the tests, total test took 5 hours. So you can imagine eighth graders sitting for 5 hours doing a test. I have a copy of a test that was given in 1895 in Kansas, which is similar to the ones given out here. My mother didn't tell me for many years that the reason she didn't graduate with her brother or ahead of her brother is because she spent 2 years in the eighth grade because she flunked the geometry section. So, but now you people who think you're so smart, and many of you have had college degrees, and some of you have masters and things like that. This is some of the questions were: give 9 rules for the use of capital letters. Now, that one wasn't too hard. But name the parts of speech and define those that have no modifications. Or define verse, stanza, and paragraph. Or what are the principal parts of a verb? Parts of a verb? Maybe adverb, and I don't know. And it says, 7 to 10, write a composition of about 150 words and show therein that you understand the practical use and rules of grammar. And then you were allowed an hour and a quarter on that, an hour and 15 minutes on that.
Is that in your book, those
yes.
points? Oh, good.
Yeah, okay. This is in the book.
Yeah.
This is, I only found 2, and this one I found one since then that was from a different state, but it was very similar. It says, name the fundamental rules of arithmetic.
Well, they don't even teach those anymore.
Hmm?
Summation, consummation, nobody knows those anymore.
And it says, a wagon box is 2 feet deep. Now, those are people who really have good minds and do these things in their head. They ought to be able to do this. A box is 2 feet deep, 10 feet long, and 3 feet wide. You can figure the square foot or a cube foot pretty easily. Now, it says, how many bushels of wheat will it hold? Well, you're from wheat country there, Ralph. You should understand. You should remember so that. A load of wheat weighs 3,942 pounds. What is it worth at $0.50 a bushel, deducting 1,050 pounds per tare? I mean, you have to think. District number 33 has a valuation of $35,000. What is the necessary levy to carry on a school 7 months at $50 per month and have $104 for incidentals? And that, you can learn that when you know how to keep your finances in order. find the cost of 6,720 pounds of coal at $6 per ton. They have known. What, find the interest of $512.60 for 8 months and 18 days at 7%.
Was the school, high school, empty?
I might.
Was the high school empty?
It says write a bank check, a promissory note, and a receipt. You're, now, history you're allowed 45 minutes for. Give the epochs, epochs into which U.S. history is divided. How many periods is in the U.S. history divided? Give an account of the discovery of America by Columbus. That wouldn't be too hard. Relate the causes and results of the Revolutionary War. We have people who were interviewed at a state college campus who don't even remember who fought in the Civil War or what it was about. Don't even know what century it was in.
Texans won't know that pretty soon.
Yeah. So, show the territorial growth of the United States. How many people know what territories were formed when? Tell what you can of the history of Kansas. This is the state that this test was from. So you had to write a history about the state. Describe three of the most prominent battles of the rebellion. Who were the following? Morse, Whitney, Fulton, Bell, Lincoln, Penn, and Howe. And name the events connected with the following dates: 1607, 1620, 1800, 1848, and 1865. Now, this is a subject called orthography. I don't even know what orthography is, so I don't know. But it says, what is meant by the following? Alphabetic, phonetic, orthography, ethnology, and syllabication. Now, when you see some of these things, one here that I like is, what is climate, and upon what does climate depend? I wish people would know the answer to that now, because we might have so much problem with deciding some of these things. Many people have said, well, they only had an eighth grade education back then. They didn't know much. Yeah. But they developed the telephone and radio and all of those things based on an eighth grade education. But you see, education was a little different in those days. They taught you different. You taught them you how to think. And Inez tells about some of the things they thought about weren't necessarily tied to education. And one of them was at Christmas time, the little room was changed into a stage. She can tell you about what happened at Christmas time.
They closed the black, because the blackboard was split in half, you know. It folded, let's say. So they would open the doors and they would bring in planks and sawhorses. And on one, in the little room, then they would put up this stage. Mm-hmm. You know, you put your sawhorses down and put the planks. And they had an ugly green curtain, ugly. If anyone went there, they knew. And they had a girl or boy stand behind and pull the curtain, that the program would start, and then it was over. They'd close the curtain. But we had a good time. But I'm thankful I went to school when the school was nice. The kids were good, and we learned. If you didn't learn, you were kind of punished. Anyhow, I thought it was wonderful. Glen Echo was a good school. Nobody from Glen Echo.
Did you have books?
Naturally.
Textbook?
Oh, no, just books to read. No, you mean...
arithmetic textbook? Math textbook?
I don't think so. No. But then again,
or English books?
Again? Has anybody else been? I don't remember that.
The very early schools in the century before only had one book, the Bible. That was the only book they had. That was their reading book, that was textbook, everything else. And even in the early days of her school, there were no math textbooks. I've got math textbooks that go back almost to that far, but they really didn't have textbooks. It was up to the teacher to teach as best they could understand how the subject was, and some teachers were very good. And in those days, when she was going, all you had to do was pass a teacher's certification test once a year, and you could teach. You didn't have to go to college, you didn't have to go to high school, you just, if you had the capability, you could teach.
They called it a state board.
Yeah.
State board test, that's it.
And the those state board tests also are available through the archives that have been preserved in Bellingham. So if you want to know how your teacher scored on her state boards, then she went, then you can find that out. But the other thing is this: most of the teachers were female. Females were not allowed to date. They were not allowed to be married. And men could date once a week, unless they went to church every Sunday, and then they were allowed two dates a week. And they could be married, but not women. And so the women who stayed, often stayed, like the ones who stayed at Inez's house, they stayed in the houses, and the kids learned, I know Inez says she learned, from the teachers who stayed in the house with them. So they were, had these things going for them. The two-room school, what she talked about, the blackboard being split, the two-room school had a divider, a floor-to-ceiling wall, and all the blackboards were on that wall. So they would push that back and make it one room, which is where it is now. The blackboards are still there. They're still intact. The dividing room is still there, but they're pushed back, and they use it as a one-room facility now. So,
but I will say, you learn in back then. You had to take tests, you know, just ordinary tests, and if you missed, you had to do it again.
So. Some of you think it was very, very safe. She thought it was pretty safe, but one experience she had indicates that it wasn't altogether safe. So if she can tell that story.
Which one?
One with the men and the car, the truck.
Oh.
California license.
I'd had chicken pox, and I was sent home from school. No, my...
Your sister.
Then I went to school.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then they sent me home. But my sister came down. I mean, she was still in school. But they sent me home. Because maybe I would expose someone. And then a car with a California license, which we didn't see very often, came. There's two men in it. One was a skinny man and one was a big guy. And so they said, "Are you walking home?" And I says, "Yes, I have quite a ways to walk yet. We lived on the old coal." And so they said, "We'll take you there. You know, you can have a ride with us." I says, "No," and I kept walking. Well, that car kept backing up and backing up. And my grandpa and grandma Thompson lived right on the corner. And so I crawled underneath the barbed wire fence. And they sat there for a while, and then they drove away. And when I got home, I told Dad. And because they said they'd stop at a yard, and it said Con Hogan on the mailbox. So he thought maybe, and my dad thought I was kind of fibbing. And so he called Con Margaret Hogan, and they said, "Yes, we saw that car We'd never seen it before, but it had this California license, and it was really kind of snooping around. So that was Everson, a quiet little Everson.
So we might not have seen her had she not had quick legs, and Grandpa Spence was right there. She jumped the ditch and went through the fence, and then she got away.
I got away.
But sometimes we don't understand that things were rather primitive then. There, South Pass was a gravel road. It was barely two cars wide. There was nobody. Nobody would have ever seen or heard from her again. She would have just disappeared, because that's the way the it was so primitive that the brush and such would cover anything else. Another thing about the early schools is that they didn't worry too much about attendance. Many of the boys, especially the boys, needed to stay out for helping on the farm. The farm where they were still trying to improve their farms, and so they needed all the labor. And so the boys had to stay home and fix things, and school was secondary. And if you got there and you, so a lot of the people had less than the normal schooling, but they still got, they had to pass the eighth grade test. And even when I went to school, about a third of my class quit at the end of the eighth grade, because of they needed to go work. And most of them worked the rest of their lives and never had anything. I know my first father-in-law was told when he was 11 years old, he told by his dad, you're old enough to take care of yourself now. And even though he stayed home, he paid rent, and he took care of himself from the time he was 11 until he died in his 80s. So things were a little different then. There was nobody to pick you up, nobody else to finance. The schools financed you. So if you were working for $30 a month, that's what you got. And if you didn't like it, you go find a job someplace else. But the she had one cousin who did get married and was a school teacher. So they had to live away from the thing and not let anybody know that he was in residence with her for the year that she retired after that year. But that year she would have been fired, and she would have not had to continue on.
But we went to see her one day. Well, this was in Seattle.
Yeah.
And we saw some men's socks. And I says, how come you have men's socks here? Oh, didn't we tell you, Inez? I'm married, and I have a husband. But the people in the country didn't know that. Because it had, you couldn't be married and be a teacher. Yeah.
So, are there any questions that you have about early schools that we could answer for you?
Where was the Nooksack School that your uncle went to located?
Okay. Nooksack had three school buildings. The first was the log cabin adjacent to Welch's house. Then they built a school which is now the southeast part of the cemetery. The cemetery, the original cemetery was the top half, the north half of the easterly section, and then the school was built on this other half. And then in 1906, the city people of Nooksack decided that they didn't want to walk up the hill anymore, and those country boys could walk another half mile to, so they built a school down in the city, and that was the school that most of us remember. Yeah. Was the one down in the city, and they tore the other one down for the lumber.
So the original one was pretty close to the Nooksack Elementary School.
The log house was actually very close where the Nooksack Elementary is now, and the second school would be a little bit further away, but not much. They were both on the hill there.
Yeah.
That's not much of a hill. Did people go by bicycle?
Excuse me?
Did people have bicycles to get to school?
That's great.
There was no way to ride bicycles. They had horses. Horses and walking. That's the way my great-grandpa, my grandma rode her horse down from Glen Echo, that was before Glen Echo was built, and rode it down, but she couldn't get across the creek with the horse, so she had a footbridge there, so he'd pick up the horse, take it home and stable it during the day, and then at night he'd bring it back to the log and she'd ride it home. That's the way he met her. She rode a side saddle.
When I was in school, there was a boy, Teddy Deem. He came down from
North Pass,
but he rode his horse, and he left it at my aunt and uncle's house during the day. Then he'd get on his horse, go home after school. Teddy Deem.
In the day, in the old days, they called school together with a bell, and he said he could remember. If he was on his horse at the house, and when the bell rang, he could make it before the second bell. And he was about 5 miles. But he was all downhill. But he remembers the bells. That he needed to be on his horse and on his way down when the first bell rang. But they lived up on the, above the North Pass, way up at the end of the... What is it? There's a little road off at North Pass that goes way up on top of the hill.
Nordham
Road. Top of the Nordham Road. That's where the Deems lived. And he'd come down every day on his horse and go home on his horse. But then a lot of people had horses in those days. Not a lot of people. Some of them had horses. Some of them rode in the story, in the Glen Echo book I tell about some of the kids would get a ride on the milk wagon. The guy that went around to pick up the cans from the various farms, and he'd go by their house and they'd just jump on the back of the milk wagon and ride it over to the school. So school transportation was, but most people walked. Most of the students walked.
And we used to have telephone poles and another line of poles. So we would run a pole and walk a pole. I don't know how to describe it.
Yeah, the poles were 300 feet apart, so they were running a block.
But they were
and
up and down,
walking
yeah.
a block.
So we'd run a pole and then walk a pole. And that's how we got to school.
Were those the telegraph lines?
They're what?
Those were telegraph lines or phone lines?
Yeah. And power poles. They had power poles
power
by that time.
Those are much closer together.
Yeah.
Telegraph
parts
farther apart. Anyway.
So, yes, Reg?
Was there homework in those days? Were you expected to do work at home?
Not really. No, there was chores to do at home. Okay. Like Inez had to clean the dropping boards under the chickens in the morning, and when she got home night, she had to get hay down for the cows and things like that. There just wasn't time for homework.
But before I went to school, when I got up in the morning, that'd be about the first thing I'd go out to the chicken house. And my sister and I, Dad had hose, and we'd pull down the icky stuff, and then we'd have to go back and take the rest of it and put it into a big barrel, big like a boiler. Oh, it was interesting. And then we had to go back in the house and practically take a shower.
I had to milk, too. Can you imagine going out in the barn and milking and standing there by a spit in the barn and then coming in and getting cleaned up and going to school? I don't know what I smelled like. But it didn't seem to bother anybody because half the boys were had done the same thing, so we probably all smell like barnyard in the schools.
Are there a story about a harsh winter or a hot summer? We're having one now, so do you remember anything like that affected the school?
It was cold. We'd have a lot of snow in the Northeaster, and my dad had two horses, but he had kind of like a sleigh. So the kids on our street, we'd come come to school, Dad would drive us up to Glen Echo School, and we'd get out, and then I think he went home again, and then he'd come back and take us, yeah, back down the road, down the north pass, what pass, south pass road.
South pass. Her dad was a logger, so in the winter there, the woods were shut down, so.
Yeah.
But the thing she remembers is that she used to complain because it would be nice and sunny, and her mother would say, you can't go to school today. And she said, why? Because we can't heat the school. If you know Glen Echo, it's primarily glass. Three walls are glass. And when that northeaster comes across that valley, there's no way anybody could ever heat that building, no matter how hot they got the wood fire going. They had two pot-bellied stoves in one little room, one big room.
But the sun was so pretty. Mom, it's such a pretty day out. I think I'll go to school. She says, no, you won't. But I wanted to go to school.
So, but other than that, they just, school was whenever they had. And in the summer, they didn't have school. They shut down. Well, even when I was in school, they couldn't go to school after the second week of June because they had picked strawberries. The strawberry crop wouldn't have picked if it wasn't for the school kids. In the fall, they couldn't go to school early because they had beans to pick. And so until the beans were all picked, they couldn't start school. Bellingham could, but the county schools couldn't. And that's kind of the way it was then. You were kept out of school to do labor. And my grandfather was, he was 13 when he came out. And of course he didn't have to come in, there was no school here when he came out, so he didn't have to go to school. So he thought he was through. He had sixth grade education back in Minnesota, and so he didn't go to school. And his older brother said, you need to finish the eighth grade. And so he promised him a Courier and Ives picture if he would go back to school. So in 1890, when he was 20 years old, he went back to grade school and finished the 7th and 8th grade and graduated in 1892. And got his Courier and Ives picture. So, but it was individual. I mean,
was there a school in Nooksack proper where the Masonic Lodge is now? Was that a gymnasium for a school?
Where the Masonic Lodge was built as a auditorium for the school originally. The school that was built was a two-story school, and it did have an auditorium above in the second floor, but they built this other building as a performing arts center, is what we would call it today. And then the Masons bought it later on.
So the school itself, was that where the Reformed Church is now in
the Reformed Church was built as a gymnasium for the school. I remember learning to play basketball in that church building.
Really?
And it was over where the residence is on the street. And the school was built where the parking lot is.
Okay.
The two-story parking lot. And where the church is and all those houses was our playground. They owned the whole block.
So was that in addition to the something in Everson, or is it?
Everson had a different school.
So they're okay. So
Everson and Nooksack were never, ever to be thought about in the same breath.
And is it still that way?
I still remember a vivid memory of my childhood. Is standing under the basket in that old, what is now the Reformed Church. Matter of fact, every time I sing in the solo in the Reformed Church, you stand up at the front, right by the nave, and I remember standing there with a basket above me, with a basketball under my arm, in a plaid shirt and bib overalls and stocking feet, and watching the Everson team snake out of the dressing room in tank tops, shorts, and matching socks, and tennis shoes. And most of the boys who became the star basketball players in my school went to that Everson school, One of them was my cousin, and I will never, we stood there shell-shocked. We had never seen a team that all had the same outfits. We had bib overalls and plaid shirts and stocking feet. I have no idea what the score of that game was, but I don't think it was pretty. I was the center because I was the tallest guy there, but I still remember that vividly.
So the school that was up where the cemetery was,
right?
Which one replaced that, or did the Nooksack and Everson replace what was on the hill?
No. Remember, we don't talk about Everson and Nooksack in the same breath.
No,
they're not ever to be confused. Nooksack always preceded everything that Everson did, but Everson always did it better before it was all over. Don can remember Everson very well because he went there. I remember Nooksack very well because I went there. She remembers Nooksack because she went there. She had a couple of years at Mount Baker, too, but Everson, whenever we consolidated in 1942, Everson said, we will not join with Everson, with Nooksack and Sumas and go to school there. We will go to Mount Baker. And for, what, 6 years? Five, 6 years, they went to Mount Baker. And those Everson kids went to Mount Baker. The Nooksack kids went to Nooksack.
And then so what was the root of this feud?
Well, there was no feud. They were two different towns. They just happened to be. Basically, Nooksack was an agricultural community, and all the business people lived. The Presbyterians lived in Everson. The Methodists and the Adventists lived in Nooksack. And never should be the Scots, should never mixed with the Germans and Scandinavians. It was very interesting, and it's still to this day. There are people who, some of my relatives in Nooksack won't even shop in Everson.
So do you think the name on that new dental office will last very long?
Probably, as long as he caters to Nooksack. Actually, that division is not near, because most of the people who live in Nooksack now don't remember what it was like in the old days. Nooksack was developed first. Nooksack had all the center, but Nooksack had a real problem with fires. Nooksack burn had 8 fires, and all the business district burned down 2 or 3 times. Well, by the time they got around to the 8th fire, Everson had built up and had become a real metropolis, quote. But you got to remember that Nooksack, it took 300 people to incorporate a town. Nooksack was incorporated in 12, Everson was incorporated in 28, 16 years later. So there was quite a difference. But whenever I was going to school, we were the poor ag kids, and they were the rich people from Everson. See, they had matching outfits and stuff like that. But the school that was up on the hill was Nooksack School. There was a log house, a log high cabin until that school was built, and I think that school was built in 1890 or thereabouts. And then in 1906, 16 years later, they built the one downtown in the main part of town. There was a little school out that used to be called Gira that later went to Sumas, and Liberty was built. Liberty is where Damtown is. It was a small town, and some of those people lived there. The Dieters went. That was Dieterville. The Dieters went to that school. So, but they were all little schools, and none of them had a coordination with any other school. They were very independent and very much governed by the people who went to that school. Like Inez's family, whole family went to that school. They all knew everything and knew everybody else. Reg.
And how were they funded if they were so independent?
By local taxation.
Okay.
But it was almost a voluntary taxation. You know, there was very, like they were saying, a budget of $50 a month.
Yeah.
That was the teacher's salary. Everything else was donated. When hot lunches came to Glen Echo, it was her aunt, who lived across the street, making a pot of soup and taking it across the street. All volunteer, all donated. There was no such thing as school. Yes, back here.
Jim, I know, I understand the difference between Everson and Nooksack schools, but you did meet for like athletic competitions. Did the schools that Everson, Nooksack, Sumas ever get together for anything else, or only sports?
Performing arts things they would do together, but not. No, I really didn't. Inez has had an interesting. She had a teacher who decided at Glen Echo that she was going to have. Was it a boys team? A basketball baseball team. Boys baseball team. Well, she had a coupe with a rumble seat. Mm-hmm. That's the way the team went to the both ball games. Nine boys piled into that coupe with a rumble seat and her, and she'd take them all to the game and they'd play. But there was no such thing as uniforms. There was no such thing as some of them had gloves, but most of them played without gloves. They just played a ball game. It was really kind of wild in some of the things they did. Any other questions?
I was told now that my mother taught at Glen Echo and that she made 95 a month, but that was in 1925.
Oh, my,
so you're talking about the earlier era, yeah.
95, wow, that was really upscale. Well, sometimes they had to. They didn't have the money, you know, to even pay the teachers. They had to go around and kind of beg from the farmers to. Of course, they didn't have to pay for a room and board.
No.
That was provided by the district.
With their mother,
yeah.
We had school really good teachers. We had school teachers that lived at our house.
Right.
Yeah.
And my mom did all their cooking, the breakfast, and made the lunch. But they usually taught at Glen Echo or.
So it was pretty hard for the teachers to sneak out and date. I mean, they were living in one of the parents' houses. But of course, she talks about friendships that were developed, that were lifelong friendships. Some of those teachers came back and visited her folks as long as they lived on the farm.
There's still there was a Goldie Abel. She was engaged to a guy. This is long time ago, and he went up to Mount Baker skiing, and he was killed. And Goldie just kind of collapsed. I remember that so plain. Yeah. But they were dedicated teachers. They'd have. They corrected papers at night, and
yeah. One story that I remember reading, and it's called The Schoolmarm, a gal in Anacortes, and I can't remember the exact year, but it was in her 1880s, I think. Anyhow, she decided she wanted to be a teacher, so she walked over to Mount Vernon from Anacortes and took the state certification and passed it, and then she walked home. And on the way back, it was getting dark before she got there, and there was a big trestle over the Swinomish Slough, and she noted, she felt something in the back, she turned around, there was a cougar following her, and they were both up on the railroad trestle by that time, and she just kept walking, and she said someplace along the line, the cougar turned around and went back, because didn't say side she wasn't such a good thing. Well, later, she took the boat up to, about where, above Woolley, a little bit, maybe to Hamilton, and got off the boat, and a guy on a horse met her there. And then she got behind him on the horse. She's dressed in a dress, you know, her Sunday best kind of thing, because she was going to go to work. And he was the guy, her transportation, took her up to probably about where Acme is, and then they forded the river because the schoolhouse was on the other side of the river. So the only thing we can get across the river is either have an animal to swim it with you, or to take a canoe. There were no canoes, so she swam across the river. And then she went and she taught in this little school. At Christmas, and she stayed with this family. And they let her go home for Christmas. And so she went back the same way, across the river on a horse, and then came back after Christmas. Fortunately, she married the guy on a horse. And she never left the valley. And she's one of the pioneering families of the Acme area. And I can't remember all the story, but I thought, how many people would do that?
We're going to take a break now. We need to change the film. This has been fascinating. I know we've got more. Save up your questions and your really interesting comments. Don't say them while we're not filming, because we want to get them on film. But we've got a few minutes while he's switching the tape, I think. And so if you want to get up, stretch a bit, there are refreshments over here. Please help yourself.
Well, a couple of interesting points is Don Ragondiver, who will be our lead speaker next month, and my wife used to ride the school bus together when they went to Mount Baker for 2 years. Yep. And they both remember each other from the school bus, and they haven't seen each other in probably 20, 30 years, maybe more than that.
And with Don, this is funny, because they, to open the door, there was a handle, and you sat behind that little rod.
And?
Yes.
Who opened the door then?
Don Reichenberg
did.
Oh,
he did. I don't remember.
Another connection is that my wife family housed a teacher whose two daughters are here tonight. And they're sitting on my right here. And they had never met each other before tonight. So little Nookchack is getting, it's Nookchat, is connecting people that were never connected before. So now a question came up about some of the other schools, and I neglected that, I'm sorry. But Roeder was a school just south of Everson across the river. And Victor Roeder was a homesteader in that area. And he built a log school. Many people from Roeder will argue this with me, but he built a little log school next to the river across from the Nolte's on the Nolte Road. And the river took that one out. The river washed that one out. So they built a new one up on the hill, and the new one up on the hill is called the Old Roeder School, and it is now part of the auction barn. And it's still there, pretty much intact, I've been told. I haven't been in there for 20 years, but the school is pretty much intact, just like the Glen Echo School is pretty much intact. Roeder, it's interesting, in his sister wrote the compendium called Whatcom History, leather-bound books in 1926, and her a total description of her brother was, he came back from school, business school, and he took up and got interested in real estate in the Nooksack area, and then he came to Bellingham. And she tells all about the stuff he did in Bellingham. But while he was in Nooksack, he had a post office, a rooming house, a store, got married, had children, homesteaded the largest homestead in the area, or had the largest farm in the area, built a school, and for her, there was none of that mentioned in the Whatcom County history. About her own brother. So you see, even the history books don't have it all. Another, I mentioned Timon. There was another school south of Roeder called Forest Grove, and most people don't even know that there ever was a Forest Grove. On the old maps, you can see that there is a railroad spur running in from the railroad track to an area along the Noon Road, and that was the Forest Grove Mill. Well, the mill workers lived very near there. As a matter of fact, they had a community of small buildings that mostly bachelors lived in, but most of the bachelors eventually got married and had children, and some of them lived in there. And they built the Forest Grove School. And there also, I found out just 2 weeks ago when I was looking through the records of the old Nooksack Methodist Church, there was a Forest Grove Methodist Church there at the same time. I don't know if it met in the schoolhouse or where they had another building. But those are two things that I haven't researched yet because they were outside my research area and I really didn't have time to go every place.
Can you talk about the South Pass School?
The South Pass School was up beyond, about 6 miles, I would say, up beyond Glen Echo. There was where Ted Deem lived, up on top of the hill, and there were a few families up beyond that. Westergreen was here early. He's one of the original homesteaders in the area. Nice story about him is when he moved, that is probably 10 miles in from the crossing, he packed his iron, cast iron cooking stove on his back, that 10 miles into his homestead. So he had a stove in his cabin in the homestead. And of course, West Greens were up there. When that little valley they settled, they developed a school called the South Pass School, which of course was primarily were West Greens and their relatives. But those people, again, they had to walk to school, so Glen Echo was too far away. So they had their little school up there. And I think that pretty well covers the schools that were close by. Any other questions?
Did Tuxedo have a school?
Tuxedo never had a school. Tuxedo, this is my son back here, he happens to know about Tuxedo because my great-grandfather had a post office from 1886 to 1890, and he named it Tuxedo. And so when my mother was born, she in 1900, she put down Tuxedo as her birthplace. And I went to college up here for 17 year quarters, and every quarter I had to explain to them that my mother's maiden name was Berg, and her married name was Berg, and that Tuxedo was a community that preceded Nooksack. But it seems that the students at Western never fully understood that those kind of things could happen. I had to explain it every quarter. Anything else? Dredge.
If you ladies felt like sharing the story of how your mother arrived here, that'd be interesting to hear a little bit about that.
There you go.
Well, we're a little, hold it up close. Oh, hold up close, okay. We're a little blurry about that. Her, she went to Bellingham Normal, and so it took 2 years to get her teaching degree then.
Now Western, yeah.
Yeah, it's now Western. And I believe from Bellingham Normal she came.
Yeah, 1925 and 26,
those two
Where
school years.
Where did she
years.
Live before?
She was in Bellingham.
She's a Bellingham girl.
Yes, she's a Bellingham girl. She went to
Rotor School.
Rotor School.
Bellingham.
Her father was a conductor on the tram that went through Fairhaven. And so he passed away when she was a teenager, and she needed to get a job right away to help support her mother.
So then she went to school after she...
And then, so she taught for 2 years in Glen Echo, and then she went down to, let's see, I think she went to Toppenish after that. She and her mother moved to Toppenish, and then she went back to the University of Washington and got, you know, took 2 more years of school, so that she had 4 years.
Then she stayed as a teacher?
Yep, taught in Seattle at John Marshall Junior High School until she retired when she was 65.
Obviously so got married someplace.
Married. She went. When she got married, teachers couldn't get married, and so she married my father secretly. They were secretly married for four years. One time they'd gone way, way up into British Columbia. You know, the only time that they would be together would when they could, you know, get away for a holiday, and they would always go far away so that they wouldn't run into anybody. And sure enough, she ran into one of the main gossips at her school.
In the hotel.
In the hotel. So we always celebrated 2 wedding anniversaries in our family.
Fond memories of Glen Echo.
Yes, very fond memories of Glen Echo and staying with Inez's family. She loved, and she would talk about going back to visit Mabel. You know, she would come back.
Right.
Yeah. Cool. Doris Myers.
Doris Myers.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Did you say you brought pictures?
Was,
yeah. Yes, we have a couple of pictures, yes.
Yes, it was Doris Myers.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So nice.
One of the pictures had her older sister in it, sitting like this little child, picking at her toes. So it was really cute.
Would we be able to pass that?
Sure, we want to copy them, yeah.
Other questions?
I wanted to mention that my aunt, Alverna Reichendiefer, had taught school at Van Zandt.
Just a second, Don. I'll get the microphone over to you.
I'm sorry to interrupt this, but I thought I might mention my aunt, Alverna Reichendiefer, taught school, went to the normal course.
Mm-hmm.
She was 16 when she taught school at Van Zandt. And I have an old newspaper that has 2000, I think it's it. And it has the description of what they had as an evening entertainment up at Van Zandt at a school that she was in. And it lists the people who were in it.
Yeah.
I've got that. I'll bring it next week.
Ah, good.
That's it.
Another story that my mother would shoot me for telling, but anyhow, she had what we call a nervous breakdown, and when she was a senior in high school, and she had the romantic lead in the annual school play, and she rose from her deathbed and did an amazing performance as a romantic lead in this school play, and then went back to bed, and as a result she didn't finish high school. And I never knew this until many years later, because she went to work in the bank. They had built a bank in Nooksack by 1920, and she went to work in the bank. And a year later, the principal at Nooksack said, if anybody can keep a job for a year, they should have a high school diploma. So she got her high school diploma, but she never finished high school. In those days, things were a little more lax than they are now, but I don't think my mother cared whether she had a high school diploma or not, but now my dad would have been important too, but Mom, I never knew that until later on, that I didn't know that she had spent 2 years in the eighth grade, and I didn't know she had not ever graduated with her class.
Is that what would be called the high school equivalency today?
Well, my mother in the eighth grade, when she was a senior in high school, maybe this is before she had her nervous breakdown, there are five boys in her class, and they were the boys' basketball team. And they went off during the school day to play a basketball game someplace, and she decided there was no sense in the girls going to school if the boys weren't going to school. And so one day the principal found that there were no senior students in school. They didn't have to even look. They just drove over to my mother's home, and there were all the girls. And they were told to go back to school, and they were going to get one grade point docked on all their grades, and they were maybe not going to be allowed to graduate. Well, needless to say, they got their grades restored, and they did graduate. But my mother had a little problem where she always thought that things should keep moving. And if they were getting a little dull, then it was her job to get them moving again.
Like father. Like Jim, like his mother.
Yeah.
Mischievous.
Oh, that's a thing. Yes.
You know, it got me thinking when Inez was describing the principal twirling the kids around and how things have changed. These days, I don't think you'd find the principal interacting physically like that. I'm curious about punishment and discipline and things like that. Was it as strict as I might imagine, or?
It depends on what you talk about. If you violated something that was assumed to be a standard, then you got disciplined and you got paddled. Every school used a paddle.
In grade school, they paddled.
Go tell.
Leroy Morningstar was his name. And it was Leroy Morningstar, Grandpa's boy. because he stayed with Grandpa because his parents were gone. But he did a prank, but he got paddled at school. I mean, he crawled underneath the legs, and everyone paddled him as he was crawling.
So he had a gauntlet. He had a gauntlet he had to go through.
So that was, and I felt
And you remember she said, mentioned about the boy having his mouth washed out for saying bad words. And, but I know in this Everson school picture, I mentioned it on Saturday, that the room above the main staircase, the second story, was known as Clint's paddling room. Clint Macbeth, many people will remember, was a very well-known person here in this community. And he was, at that time, the Everson coach. He was a guy that came to Nooksack with these people in these uniforms. And but he, if you went to the principal's office, even when I was in school in the 40s, late 40s, there was a paddle there. And you were paddled. And usually you could hear the paddle meeting its target, and you often there was some repercussion from the mouth of the person being paddled. It wasn't a light tap. It was something you would remember. When I was a little kid back in Pennsylvania, I thought if you went to the principal's office, you never came back. And then I didn't find out until years later that my big sister used to go there and come back. And, but I never went there. I got as far as the cloakroom, but I never got as far as the principal's office because I knew that was the end. But it was, and that was expected, you know. But how many schools would allow children to jump off the school, the woodshed, and knock themselves out? And there's also the outhouses, you know. Things happened around the outhouse that weren't necessarily apropos. And these, so it was different, but the boys going barefooted at recess, they wouldn't allow that now. And they'd get dirty, and it was just much different. But, you know, now they're not allowed to play dodgeball anymore. How much fun we had playing dodgeball. So, other questions? Reg?
I'd just like to ask Inez what her most favorite parts of the school day were and the least favorite parts of the school day.
Most favorite and least favorite.
Me?
You see where I get this humor, huh?
With my students.
Have you?
My college girls.
No.
What, at Glen Echo. What was your most favorite thing at Glen Echo?
Teacher.
What was your least favorite thing?
I'd have to think.
She liked school real well, so
it
wasn't. She didn't have very much that she didn't like.
And my mom housed teachers, so I was, you know, just one of them.
Yeah. You may, most of you don't know, but she went on in 1958 to start a college rooming house for girls, and she's now housed over 600 college girls from Western in her house.
And I used to cook for them.
And she cooked for them, and she did their washing for them.
And I was pregnant.
And she was pregnant. And the thing I remember her stories about, she was their mother. Most of these girls, especially in the early 50s and late 50s, most of these girls have never been away from home. And they didn't know anything. Many of them didn't know how to cook. Some of them didn't know how to make their bed. They thought she was going to make their bed for them.
And do their laundry. I did their laundry,
yeah, too. There was many situations that she had, but she became the surrogate mother for hundreds of girls, and she's had four or five of the girls got married in the house, and she was the first babysitter of a couple of her students, and she had a very interesting and schooling. Now, I didn't have quite as fun time with school as she did.
But I started out with boys. I had boys in my house. And I decided I was going to change and cook. Boys couldn't afford it. So that's when I changed to girls. But I had 24 girls at a time that I cooked for and did laundry and cried with them.
That's why she got 600 girls. Plus, it probably worked out better because she had four daughters. So it was probably better that she had girl students than boy students. But of course, she didn't lose her boy students either because she had been living in a house before she moved into the boarding house. And so she rented the boys her house. And so they moved from their boarding house into her former residence. And she had, they were friends for all 4 years they were in school.
But they were all good kids. I think if you trust them, you get more out of them. I trusted them.
So she's had a lot of history in education.
I was thinking back to those early school years, Inez. I wonder if you can remember what recess time looked like for the girls and for the boys.
Recess time for girls.
Recess. I think if we could go outside to play, we would. If it rained, no. I think we'd play games on the blackboards.
The boys and girls pretty much played the same games.
Yeah.
If you look at the pictures, the girls would get down and dirty just as much as the boys were down and dirty. And yeah, they were swinging on swings. And I remember the days when the swings were high and you tried to swing as high as you could. If you fell off one of those things, you got hurt. Mm-hmm. I don't know if any of you did this sort of thing, but the seesaws were long 2x12s normally, and they were long. And if you got somebody way up in the air and you stepped off, that person on the other came down really quick. And that was so much fun. The only way you could stop that is to slide down the thing. And of course, there was a possibility of slivers in the slide, so, and the teeter-totter.
Everston still has a pretty old-fashioned one in comparison to most of them.
And now they won't even let anything you might get hurt on in the playground. But people got hurt. But they were patched up at school, and that went on with school day.
At recess time, there were two boys who took the swings, and they'd go fast as they could and go clear on over the watched them.
And the only problem is I always got scared when the chains went slack, when you got up beyond the point where you couldn't keep them going.
When did they incorporate into the modern school system? When did Glen Echo and all these other schools go out?
42. There was a consolidation in 30. That was the one that Everson wouldn't join with Nooksack. And then there was a consolidation in 42, and that ended all of the little schools. All of them went to bigger schools. And that would be, I would say, the beginning of the modern era.
So why did Everson go to Mount Baker?
That's a good question.
There was no Nooksack Valley School then.
Yes, there was. They joined in 30.
And before we didn't have it, I didn't think.
What I have been told is that the Everson people would not join with the Nooksack people under any circumstances. And even whenever they did join in 42, they joined on one condition, that it be named the Everson Nooksack Sumas School instead of the Nooksack Sumas School. And in 1948 or 49, they changed it to the Nooksack Valley School District again. It was originally the Nooksack Valley School District in 1884, but it was not until 48 that it became Nooksack Valley again.
And that incorporated Nooksack, Everson, and Sumas, right?
The consolidation for us was Everson, and there was another consolidation, which I was on the school board, and the school board doesn't even know about this, but I found out that in 1918, Clearbrook wanted to have a four-year high school, and Nooksack did have a four-year high school, and so they joined with, the high schools joined. They had a two-year high school at Clearbrook, and they wanted a four-year. So they joined with Nooksack at Nooksack, but they graduated as Clearbrook and Nooksack, but they were called the Victory School District.
I remember the name.
And because I was looking through the census records, and all of a sudden Nooksack disappeared, and I couldn't figure out where they went. And then I found this Victory School District, and I couldn't figure out where that was because I'd never heard of Victory School. And so I looked up the names, and I said, those names are Clearbrook names and Nooksack names. So then I researched a little further, and I found out that in 1919, they became the Victory School District, and they were Victory School District until 30, when they joined with Sumas. And then, of course, Clearbrook didn't have a high school anymore, and they built a new high school that was midway between Sumas and Nooksack. And, of course, Everson went to Mount Baker. So, Inez wanted to take piano lessons, and Mount Baker offered free piano lessons. And her family could not afford piano lessons, so she went to Mount Baker to take piano lessons.
For two years. But I had to walk.
And the Nooksack bus went right by our house, but the Mount Baker bus, closest point was a mile away. So she walked a mile down to the motor inn to get the Mount Baker bus, then which Don Rackendiver was already on, so she always remembered that.
I had to walk from right near Nooksack all the way to Everson one day. The bus driver told me to get off because I was hooping it up.
You got kicked off the bus?
I did, yeah.
Not Don Rackendiver.
I did.
But he was seated in that seat.
Yeah. I don't remember that.
The question was raised about bicycles early on. There were no way to ride a bicycle. The roads were so bad that even in the late 40s when I was learning to ride a bike, you could not learn to ride a bicycle on the roads because they were all gravel roads, very loose gravel. So you learned I learned in our Gilbert orchard where I could fall and it was nice and soft. But it was hard riding too. But I remember once my front wheel locking, and I'm going over the handlebars and landing on all four points, and I tore both my elbows out and both my knees out landing on that loose gravel. And then, of course, they came out with these narrow wheeled bikes. There's no way you could ride, and they had to have pavement for that. So the big balloon tires, we could ride on gravel, but it was so difficult and it was so tiring that people walked. Even like I would walk to Everson rather than try to ride a bike to Everson, 2 miles. So, you make me sound like I went to an early school. I'm only 80 years old. I can't be that. I thought Inez, of course, went earlier than I. She has an interesting, one of the pictures in the book is the teacher lived up on the Breckenridge Creek. It's about a half mile from the school. And so she had she just invited all the students to walk home with her, and they had a picnic in the creek. Well, one of her cousins was told, don't go in the creek. And there's a picture in the Nooksack book, in the Glen Echo book, which shows Thorwell standing in the middle of the creek with his pants rolled up so they wouldn't get wet. And I don't know if he knew, because the picture's being taken. They didn't, in those days they had to pose pictures. and the teacher took the picture, and he got into trouble for violating the rules of home. I remember the day, earlier days, not with me, but people a little bit older said, if you get in trouble in school, just wait till you get home. So then the student was never believed over the teacher. The teacher was always right, the student was always wrong, which is about 180 degrees from where we are today.
That's true. Yeah, in San Francisco, the bicyclists were the drive for paved roads way before the...
Yes. We had in those days what we called the pavement. The Lawrence Highway was a pavement, the Everson Road was a pavement, the pole road, but everything else was gravel. And those, but they were paved very early. But like the Pacific Highway was paved in 21. So up until 21, there was no pavement in the county. That's the first concrete road was what became known as our Mexico to BC Highway now. We call it Interstate 5 now. But we used to have go down the Pacific Highway and down Chuckanut. And Chuckanut was the main drive, main highway between Bellingham and South Point South.
Now it's called the 101.
Hmm?
The 101, Highway 101.
It became 101, yeah. It is, by the way, it is the oldest scenic highway in the United States.
Really?
By 3 months.
3 months.
The scenic highway in Long Island became, when they put the bridge in, Long Island became part of the mainland. So that eliminated that scenic highway, and there's another scenic highway on the East Coast, which became a scenic highway 3 months after Chuckanut did. So, you know how Chuckanut was built?
No, I don't.
The brickyard.
Hmm?
The brickyard.
Brick?
They got a brickyard down there.
They took the prisoners, the jail inmates down with pick and shovel. And they picked that whole thing open with prisoners. So we got some use out of those people earned their pay. Because that was tough going. Okay, I think we pretty well covered early schools. There are lots of stories, but one of the stories that we'll go... They're not named, but we had we had hot water registers that heated our school, and they had casings over so we students wouldn't touch the hot radiator and get burned. And one day when we got to school, this is the high school, Sumas Nooksack High School. One day when we got to school, it didn't smell good. And somebody had gotten in, and I found out, I know who they are, they were in my high school class. Got in over the weekend and put Limburger cheese on all the radiators.
And that happened to my day too.
And so whenever the teachers got there and turned on their radiators, by the time they found out that there was cheese on it, it was melted down through the radiator. I remember our art teacher liked it cool, so he didn't turn his radiator on. And whenever everybody else was having smelly rooms, he didn't have a smelly room because he went in and took the Limburger cheese off before he put it on, before he turned the heater on. But there were still things like that going on in schools, in the early schools, Karen. Are you that, or Elaine, are you that old? Do you remember the early school?
No, but in my day we had Limburger cheese too in Nooksack Valley, in the accounting teacher's room.
They probably didn't learn from previous students, did they?
I think I could tell you his name. I'm not quite sure.
There was one, three years ago, we had a teacher that came back to Nooksack Valley High School reunion, which is the old timers, graduated from high school 50 years ago, are meeting next Saturday at the elementary, Nooksack Elementary. And 2 or 3 years ago, they had a teacher that came back. He's 106. And he says, I never did know who put or fixed my car. He went out to start his car one day, and smoke poured out from under the hood of his car. and I can't remember exactly what they did, but he says, is anybody here know who did that? Because I wondered all of these years who did that. And there was some of this, it was Daryl Ellers, and he fessed up to it. He says, well, you know, but he says, I knew probably nothing was wrong with the car, but I knew that somebody thought I would think so was something wrong with the car. And that was probably in the 40s, I think he was there. He was an ag teacher. So, any other pranks that anybody remembers? The reason they tore the gym down on the Glen Echo School is because the guy that was maintaining it across the eye got tired of local people riding their horses around inside there on rainy days. And he said, somebody's going to get hurt in there riding those horses around inside the gym on rainy days. So he convinced the Glen Echo Club to tear the bar, the gym down. Because there were no doors on the thing, so they can go in and out of it as they wanted. And the thing they didn't remember, I remember, they had a grand piano in that gym.
They did. There, but there was a little room.
Yeah, a little room. And they did also at Liberty. They had a little room and they had a grand piano in there.
Grand piano.
So that was for stage presentations. That was for the Performing Arts Center type things they had. Because they did have artists come in once in a while, or people that could play, like Dawn, and play concerts for them. And there were local people. A lot of fiddling, a lot of dancing in the school. Anybody else?
I just wondered if anybody here has a memory of Glen Echo Community Club.
Of course, year after year, after month after month.
Me too.
Yeah, there's, and of course they still call themselves a community club.
So yeah.
They would love to have more. They now have swing dances up there, which has really helped bring in people to appreciate the school, because they've done a nice job of bringing it up to date, putting a new foundation under it, new finishing the floor, putting a new roof on it, painting it. Mm. So they've done it, and put inside plumbing in it. Got inside plumbing in it, so.
Did they put a bell in again?
And they put the original bell back. So the original bell disappeared and was gone for about 25 years. And then one day somebody said that they had been out in their barn rummaging around the hay. They found this bell. And they wondered if the people would like it back. Now there were people who guessed whose barn it was in, but up until then, nobody knew for sure, and anyhow, they got their bell back. It was quite a caper, because the Glen Echo people had bought another bell from a place in Idaho. Mount Baker had torn down their Kendall School and given their bell to the Kendall Chapel. And so they built a new school at Kendall, and they wanted their bell back to put up as a memorial at the school. Well, that would mean the chapel didn't have a bell. Well, by that time, Glen Echo had gotten their bell back, so they didn't want the bell they had bought previously. So Mount Baker School District took all three bells, refurbished them, polished them up, got them all going, and reinstalled them in the right belfries. So all three people came out winners on that one. And Mount Baker School District is the one that did the hard work. Well, it's hard. They figure it was one of the guys at the mill, which is right next door, loaned out one of his real big wrenches one night to some high school kids, I think it was. But anyhow, they returned later on that night and returned his wrench to him. But that was a 300 or 400 pound bell. Was taken out of a belfry over a railing and down to the ground some way, and then hauled back to the barn, their family, the folks' barn. The folks never knew the barn, the bell was there, until many, many years later, when the hay got so low that they finally saw this thing sticking out of the hay, and by that time the boys were adults and long gone from home and had probably forgotten the caper. I think that will we'll cut it off there for the day.
I think thank you.